Good afternoon, everybody. We welcome you all, and thankfully it's not raining today, but the sun is trying to come out. And you are going to be have rays of sunshine with the wonderful program that we have set aside for you today about Puccini and the composers that influenced him and those who were influenced by him. So just a few details. I don't know if you noticed, but we have a shuttle service. Technically speaking, they don't want parking on the road that approaches the mansion because it's against fire regulations. So there's a parking lot behind the mansion. It's not, it's not that easy accessible. So we are providing shuttle service. So once that, and it's free. So once you park there, they will take you here, and it says FDU security, and it's free, and it'll take you back after the program. So I advise you to use it. And we've been doing this for a while now, but it wasn't clear to everybody. And we had a wonderful pre-concert lecture, and that was done by Mark Fine, who teaches opera with the Fairleigh Dickinson Lifelong Learning Program. So it's all Puccini today, and of course, we can't deny his greatness. Okay. In the program book, on the last page, is the new season for next year. We begin in September. The dates may change. The dates look maybe a little different. But this room is highly competitive. The university uses it. It's used for private parties and weddings. So it's highly competitive. But these are the dates that we were able to provide at this time. But more or less, they will stay. But I'm just letting you know, if you check our website, keep current if there's any changes. In the program book also, there is a donation card. I know I don't usually do this, but as you know, with all arts and music organizations, the ticket sales do not cover the administrative expenses of the organizations. So, we'd like you to consider it, take it home, think about it, do it now, do it later, whatever you can do would be appreciated. I also want to ask, how many are here for the first time today? We want to sort of, well, at least about five or six. We want to test out how our PR is doing. We went on a lot of social media, which maybe some of you don't partake of, but like myself. But we try to get the message out in as many ways as possible. And there are extra programs left later. Take home, take the page out, post it, give it to your friends, post it in the gyms, churches, synagogues, wherever you can to get, because there's a lot of opera people, opera lovers out there. And every time they come here for the first time, they say, I never heard about you. And we've been here 35 years. And we want to be here some more in the future, but we need people. Good. And the other, shall we say, plea, is that we need volunteers. So any of you that would like to help us, you see the people that it takes to get paid for, no paid for, whether you're a subscriber or this and that. It takes a lot of people to put a show on, period. So whatever you can do, and you can ask us questions, comments, positive or negative, I'm open to everything. You can get my ear later on. Okay, we're ready for the show. And we have our vice president and artistic director and accompanist. She has many, many titles. That's Mary Pinto, who is also a private vocal coach. And we're just so proud to have her. She puts together these programs and obtains these singers that you see are all highly professional, qualified opera vocalists. And here's Mary Pinto.
But I have three of my dearest friends here together. Two of these people I met Our tenor today, Roy Hage, came off the beach in Miami where he was sunbathing. This boy got ill, and I think Meryl and I found out about 10 o'clock the day of the recital. Meryl was going to do a couple numbers on it. Debbie, who was singing 22 numbers on the program I had for her, was not coming due to the snowstorm of being sick. So they called Roy, who was sunbathing on the beach in Miami, and drove 3 or 4 hours, brought his iPad, and we performed for 500 people, and they were amazing. So I love Roy Hage tenor. So I know Mr. Fine gave a beautiful lecture on Puccini. So I'm not going to talk in nauseam because we're here to listen to some gorgeous singing. But I just wanted to give you a little background on how I chose the music that I chose for today. I kind of did it in chronological order, but I got a little confused in one regard that I mixed up the Edgar and the O&M selections. They should be reversed, because the time on the operas is not the time I gave you the program, so I'm sorry about that. Puccini was the last descendant of a family that for 2 centuries had provided musical directors of the Cathedral of San Martino in Lucca. Puccini initially dedicated himself to music, therefore not as a personal vocation, but as part of a family profession because he had lost his father at 5, who was an organist for this church. He was orphaned at the age of 5 because of his father passing on, and the municipality of Lucca supported the family with a small pension and kept the position of cathedral organist open for Giacomo until he became of age. In autumn of 1880, he went to study at the Canto Conservatory, where his principal teachers were Antonio Bazzini, a famous violinist and composer of chamber music, and Amicare Pompieri, the composer of our first aria from our first opera, La Gioconda. So in this aria that Roy is going to sing, Cinque de Mar, first of all, I want to say that I try to get a lot of the winners from our competition able to come. And they were all three of them were engaged. So I booked these singers 2 weeks ago for this program. And because of that fact, some of them will be using music for the arias. Roy learned these arias literally for me 2 weeks ago to fit into the program. Some people will be using music stand, which I said was so fine, and I'm thrilled that he could be here. So in this opera, Barnaba has decided he must win Giacomo by proving to her that her lover, Enzo, who is actually the character that Roy is today, singing this beautiful aria, is a faithless, good-for-nothing human being. However, Enzo comes on the scene, and he shows the virtue of the sky and the sea in this aria, Cielo e Mare. Sky and sea, the ethereal veil shines like a holy altar. Will my angel come from sky, will my angel come from the sea? I await here ardently the wind of love breezes today. Oh, that man who sighs will vanquish all dreams of gold through the dense atmosphere. Appears neither earth nor mountain. The horizon kisses the waves. Come, oh my lady, come to the kiss of life and of love. Oh, please come. So here I present to you Roy Hage, and I, Cielo e Mare.
Thank you.
Okay, so after the death of his mother, Puccini left Puccini with a married woman, Elvira Giminati. Finding in her passion and courage to defy the truly enormous scandal generated by their illegal unions, they lived at first in Lanzania, Milano, where a son, Antonio, was born. However, living with Elvira proved very difficult. She was tempestuous rather than compliant, and she was justifiably jealous and was not an ideal companion. Thus, in 1895 came the creation of La Bohème, and in it, I believe, this little tribute to Elvira was born in Musetta's Waltz from the opera La Bohème.
Thank you. Thank you.
before the Bohem. That was the way it goes. It was introduced and commissioned by Puccini's publisher, Florham, who was his publisher for most of his operas. And the name of the opera was Edgar. It's a little-known stage work that he wrote, and it was Puccini's actual first full-length opera. It was introduced in 1889 to a very cool reception. It led to multiple revisions of the opera and never really took hold in an opera house. However, our beloved youth brother, who has been a huge supporter of the Urban Listener Foundation, which has been a huge supporter for opera form, premiered the opera in 1977 in Carnegie Hall with a first rate cast. The libretto centers on a Flemish knight of the title who jilts a virtuous village girl, Fidelia, and runs off with the Moorish seductress, Tigrana. Eventually, tiring of his endless orgies, Edgar joins the army to repent, with the help of Fidelia's brother, Frank, who is going to be Matthew, a rival comrade. Edgar stages his own funeral and humiliates Tigrana for revenge. She murders Fidelia. The end. Despite that ridiculous scenario, Edgar is worth hearing. It contains clear imitations of that on a butterfly, especially Tosca, in which Puccini reused music he had cut from Edgar. There's a very famous soprano aria by Guillaume and Dolce Amore, and Matthew and Roy both are going to sing amazingly gorgeous, gorgeous arias from this opera. And Questo Amore is the work that Matthew, if he chooses to explain anymore, if not. If you're good, we'll go ahead and do that first.
My character Frank, in this case, is jilted by Tigrana, who is a childhood friend of his, who he's been in love with practically his whole life. She scorns him because she feels that she has that's almost a brother-sister-like relationship with him. So to be his lover would be a sin. And here he's singing about how much he still loves her, even though she berates him.
Thank you.
Roy tell you a little bit about the genesis of where the tenor is in this opera at this point.
So this is an aria of the title character, Edgar, and he has left this life of debauchery to begin a faithful life. And Tigrana has approached him, and she is a very convincing woman, and he's fighting with his emotions at this point, of whether to, fighting that away and calling that a terror. So you'll hear that there's lots of interplay between us. It sounds like he's being overwhelmed by terror and then seeing this beautiful vision.
Thank you.
and we're going to want to go hear it again. And those are arias that don't come up maybe in the opera that's not done that often, but I put in the audition a lot. I might see West for water out of my plan for the Gary competition, so I'm about to play for 225 people in the next 3 days. I may sequester a more about 5 times. Sometimes not at all, you never know. So to me, it's always exciting to be exposed to new words. This Kido Sonia Maris can embrace us with is part of our aria that came from La Rondine. Again, Puccini offered this work to his editor, Tito Ricordi, who declined to buy it, dismissing it. It was bad opera. So we didn't want to be part of this opera. Now this opera is done quite a bit. And this aria is an incredibly beautiful aria. And what is going on in this aria? The synopsis is, after Marietta, played by Meryl at this moment, has made a toast with the rest of her troop, she asks Fritz to sing a song. He sings a yearning dance song that looks into his past. Oh, I'm sorry, wrong opera. Sorry.
You want to
talk
about
it?
Yeah, sure.
I have it somewhere. That was not it. Sorry.
Story of love, and in the end, it doesn't work out. But that's a fair assessment of a lot of operas. But this scene in particular is very interesting. Manga, that is at a party, and her friend, the gay poet, is telling a story that he's trying to write the end of it, but he has writer's block. So he asks her to come up with a solution to the end of the story. And she starts repeating what he said, thinking about it, and in the middle of this, she spins off and starts thinking about her own lack of love life. So later, she meets the hero of the story and everything goes on. But this is the introduction aria to the character.
Pick me up for Germany. But my character, Pierrot, is simply asked to sing a song. And this is the song that depicts singing about the land that they once had and dreaming about it reminiscent.
Quickly, my urine finds session, they take my back and dreams. In the dance I once obtained it, now I've lost my happiness by dancing on the rock in the moonlight. She confessed to me with a loving look in her blue eyes, confessed to me with her pleading words, oh, stay, don't go far away. Preserve the memory of your moments, peaceful, flourishing happiness. I bring you Matthew Ciuffitelli, mine is
Tanzen
movement and conflict. It must contain moments of repose, contemplation, and lyricism. And I hope that you have felt that in this first half of this program. Here is Meryl to explain our final aria for the evening afternoon.
Thank you. So the plot of this opera is a very strange plot. Guozzo is a very wealthy man in Florence, and probably within the first 30 seconds of the opera, he dies. So all of his relatives show up, trying to claim all the inheritance money, trying to find the will and see what happens. And Lauretta, the character that I was seeing for Aria, is in love with Renuccio, one of the young sons of the family. And so she convinces her father, who is a notorious con man, who's trying to help all the family members out, to really try to help them out, because that way she can get married to her boyfriend. And everybody thinks that this aria is very sweet and kind, but she's really kind of throwing a temper tantrum to convince her dad to do what she wants. So I think it's very, very funny that it's gotten that reputation. So I hope you enjoy Obi Bambino Caro.
the entire time I'm playing it. But, and there, you hear some of Puccini in that, right? That you've heard in the operas, hopefully today, you've heard a few things that make you think of the very mind this man must have had. And a lot of humor in his works, too. The second piece I'm going to play is even shorter. It's one page long. It's called Penso per pianoforte, piece for pianoforte. So I hope that you enjoy it.
Thank you.
this next song is one of my favorite songs ever, and it is Morbid by Strauss. It is the last of the set of four songs that Strauss composed for his wife, his wedding present. And the poetry is so beautiful that she describes morning as the sun coming back up from essentially being asleep, and he and his love walking down the beach and staring into each other's eyes. And it's just a beautiful sense of waiting for the morning just so that he could wake up with his love, because going to sleep is just simply too long to be away from her. So it's very, very beautiful.
Enjoy.
day of the Debbie Williams on there singing two arias. We figured out our program. Meryl figured it out overnight because she didn't sleep much that night. And I found out about the program at 3 p.m. that day. And she said, "Do you know what I heard?" And I was like, "Yeah, no, I don't even know." So at 5 o'clock on our dinner break, I went home and listened to somebody on YouTube and learned it in 10 minutes. And came back and performed it for 500 people. So I'm so glad. I was so lucky to be able to come back and play for her here when I know the piece is longer than 10 minutes. So, and she is stunning. Here is the next piece we're going to be doing, Roy is going to talk about.
If you've met a dirty epic modern, such a translates to the ocean is even more beautiful than the cathedrals. And it's a text by Berlin in which I sing about how the ocean is both so beautiful and calm, but at the same time has these really terrible and terrifying things. So it's a very, very beautiful song that goes through describing the good and bad aspects of the sea.
Understand. where the character Alex is talking about past 17 years of his love life and how love changes everything.
Thank you. talk of talkers, forget these wide-eyed fears. I'm here, nothing can harm you. My words will warm and calm you. Let me be your freedom. Let daylight dry your tears. I'm here with you beside you.
Enjoyed this as much as I just enjoyed it an hour and a half ago when I rehearsed it. Thank you.